Where there is law, there is wrath. Something like that. In John, Romans chapter 4, verse number 15. Again, no need of following the law. So can you imagine Jesus when he's alive, he's saying, keep the commandments. When he's lifted up to the heavens, in the vision, he's coming to Jesus, Paul, and he's saying, don't keep the commandments. How can you accept this? Is it possible to accept this? That when he's alive, he's saying, keep the commandments. When a rich person comes to Jesus Christ asking, what good thing shall I do to enter the kingdom of heaven? He said, keep the commandments. And now he's saying, don't keep the commandments in the vision. Can we accept this? So he's fooling people. He says in Galatians chapter 3 verse 25. Galatians chapter 3 verse 25. Now faith has come. We are no longer under the supervision of the law. Now faith has come. We are no longer under the supervision of the law. So he's abolishing the law. Now faith has come. We are no longer under the supervision of the law. See, Paul is now a new disciple. In other words, new disciple. He should learn from the disciples, previous disciples, the present disciples, the other disciples. This was the procedure. This should be a procedure. But here he's not learning from the disciple. He's teaching the disciples. It's the opposite. And he says that. He justifies himself. Instead of learning from disciples, he starts teaching the disciples and justifies his stand by Galatians chapter 1, verse number 11 to 12. Galatians chapter 1, verses 11 to 12. Galatians chapter 1, verses 11 to 12. And he says, I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after men. It is not from men. The gospel which is preached by me, preached of me, with the gospel that I am giving you out, the good news that I am giving out, it is not from men. For neither received it of men. I did not receive from any man. I did not got it from any person. And it is not taught by any man. Neither was I taught. Neither anybody taught me. I am not learning from anyone. Neither anyone taught me. But the revelation from Jesus Christ. This is from the from Jesus Christ I am getting the revelation. I am getting direct from Jesus Christ. What I am getting? That by observing the law, no one will be justified by the law. By observing the law, no one will be justified. This is what he's getting. All things are lawful to me, but I will not be brought under the law. This is all. No flesh will be justified by the deeds of the law. He is now getting this message. So this is not from any man. I am getting from revelation from Jesus Christ. This is his claiming. So Paul corrupted the religion of Jesus Christ which was upon him. He corrupted the religion of Jesus Christ. Paul produced a religion with encompassed different contradictory elements. He took the Unitarianism of the Jews. Jews, they believed in one God. He took the Unitarianism of the Jews and added to it the philosophy of the pagans. And he added with the philosophy of the pagans. This admixture was combined with some of what Jesus had taught and some of what Paul claimed Christ had revealed to him. So he had an admixture of what teaching of Jesus Christ and what he thought that Jesus has revealed to him. Paul's theology was based on his personal experience. Paul's theology was based on his personal experience. Interpreted in the light of contemporary Greek thoughts. Jesus was deified. Jesus was made into God. And the words of Plato were put in his sacred mouth. Words of Plato was put in the sacred mouth of Jesus. So he was made into God. The original sin, the crucifixion, the resurrection, a synthetic religion was created, and that is Christianity. So Paul is responsible for this. And Hind Zandt, H-E-I-N-Z. E-H-E-I-N-Z. Hins Zarnd. Z-A-H-R-N-T. H-E-I-N-Z. Hins Z-A-H-R-N-T. Zarnd. He calls Paul a corrupter of the gospel of Jesus. A corrupter of the gospel of Jesus. He calls Paul a corrupter of the gospel of Jesus. This is there in the book, The Jesus Report by Lehman, Johannes, page 126. Schonfield says, Pauline heresy became the foundation of the Christian orthodoxy. Pauline heresy became the foundation of the Christianity. And legitimate church was disowned as heretical. Legitimate church was converted into heretical. And Pauline theology was considered to be orthodox Christianity. So Christianity put forward by Paul became the orthodox Christianity, true Christianity. And the true legitimate Christianity is the Islam. It became a heretical, deviated, heretical body. This again is mentioned by Jesus in the Jesus Report, Johannes Lehman, page 127. I'm not saying, these scholars are saying that Pauline heresy became the foundation of Orthodox Christianity and legitimate church, Islam, legitimate church became heretical, was disowned as heretical. And in the Bible, Paul himself says that I can lie. If I lie, there is no sin. I can lie. Romans chapter 3, verse number 7. And he lied. Verse 7. Romans chapter 3, verse 7. If truth of God is more abounded through my lie, why am I judged as a sinner? If truth of God is more propagated, more widespread, if truth of God is more abounded through my lie, why am I judged as a sinner? Why am I a sinner then? So he can lie for the glory of God. He can lie. So he lied. All these things are lies only. He lied. He says in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse number 21 to 22. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse number 21, 22. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse number 21 to 22. For the Jews, I became like Jews. For the Gentiles, I became like Gentiles. For those who are under the law, I became those like under the law. For those who are without law, I became like without law, so that I can gain them. Why am I becoming like this? So that I can gain them. He's saying that in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse number 21, 22. For those who are under the law, as under the law. For those who are without law, as without law. As Jews. For Gentiles, as Gentiles. So that I can gain them. Now, all this he is entitled to do because he saw vision of Jesus Christ at Damascus. That is the starting point. He was walking on the Damascus road and he saw the vision of Jesus Christ appearing to him. And this story you will find about the vision of Jesus Christ is upon him in Acts chapter 9, Acts chapter 22, Acts chapter 26, three places, 9, 22, 26. Three places you will find the story of the vision of Jesus Christ is upon him coming to Paul. Now here what you have to do, you don't read vertical reading of the Bible. Do a horizontal reading of the Bible. If you do horizontal reading of the Bible, you will find several discrepancies. If you take the birth of Jesus Christ mentioned in Mark, birth of Jesus Christ mentioned in Matthew, Mark, birth of Jesus, if you do a horizontal reading, you write it, have it here, have it side by side, and you do a horizontal reading, you will find several discrepancies. In a similar way, you do this horizontal reading. I have done this. I have made chapter 9 one side, chapter 22 side by side, and chapter 26 side by side. 9, 22, 26. And if you do this homework, what you will discover is that he is lying. You will discover that he is lying. One place he says that he fell down on the ground and everyone was standing. In other places, he says everyone fell down. One place says that he heard and everybody stood speechless. In other places, everyone heard. One place says vision came fall on me, on another. So like that, you have 4 or 5 discrepancies and many more discrepancies if you read horizontal reading. So here we find that he's lying. He said that he can lie and he's lying. And he changed the religion of Jesus Christ based upon it. Due to the teachings of Paul, a group of Christians came to existence. We can name now such Christians as Trinitarian Christians. Trinitarian Christians. Do you agree? By the teachings of Paul, a group of Christianity came into existence. The followers of Paul came into existence. And we can term this group as Trinitarian Christians. But by the teachings of disciples, disciple of Jesus Christ is upon him, there were followers of disciples also, true teachings of Jesus Christ is upon him also. They were Unitarian Christians, you can name. And these were the Muslims, Unitarian Christians. And such Unitarian Christians were also in large numbers, great numbers. Unitarian Christians and Trinitarian Christians were due to the influence of Paul. Due to the teachings of Paul, this type of Christian came into the Trinitarian Christians and the Unitarian Christians. So when these two main group came into existence, there were conflicts between these two groups. Trinitarian Christians and Unitarian Christians. There were continuous conflicts between this group. And there were many other groups later on. Among these groups was one Donatus, a Bishop Donatus, Unitarian Christian, Donatus. Belonged from the Berber communities of North Africa. From the North Africa area, Donatus belonged to a Berber community. He was a Unitarian Christian, follower of Jesus Christ, peace upon him, true teachings of Jesus Christ, peace upon him. In 313 CE, Donatus was chosen from among these people as their bishop. In 313, it is before 325. 313, he is chosen as a bishop of the church. For 40 years, he remained the leader of the church, which continued to flourish in opposition to Bishop of Rome. For 40 years, he remained a bishop in opposition to the Bishop of Rome, the Trinitarian Christians in Rome. Donatus, D-O-N-A-T-U-S, Donatus. According to Jerome, you know Jerome? Jerome, who made the Vulgate Bible, who was asked to write the Vulgate Bible, Jerome. According to him, Jerome, Donatism became the religion of nearly all North Africa with a generation. All the North African people, they were all Donatists and they were all Unitarians, true followers of Jesus Christ, and neither force nor argument could change them. No force. They were so powerful and no force, no argument could change them. They flourished. Alhamdulillah. Once a Trinitarian church, they built a church, Trinitarian church in his area. In the area of the Donatists, Unitarian Christians. But the Donatarians, the Unitarian Christians were so powerful, they occupied the Trinitarian church built in the area. They established themselves. They outnumbered and this church became the Unitarian Church. So they were so strong for quite long period. But several attempts failed to soften Donatus, despite later Donatus and his people were crushed and their books burnt by Constantine. The Donatists kept increasing, and after 300 years, with the advent of Islam, Donatists embraced Islam en masse. In later period, they were crushed by Constantine. Constantine will come into picture later, inshallah. I will continue with that. So this is how Donatists is one, a group of North African Unitarian Christians. Another person, a great hero of Unitarians, were Arius. A great hero of Unitarian Christians, true Christians or Muslims, were Arius. He lived between 250 to 336. Arius. He was the bishop of the church of Bucalis in Alexandria. He was a Libyan by birth. He was regarded as one of the most remarkable presbyters in Alexandria and was held in high esteem by anyone who met him. Anyone who met him, he was influenced. He was impressed by Arius. He was such a personality. It is known that he had the following of not less than 700 of the Christian ladies of Alexandria. He gave the motto against Paul's innovation: follow Jesus as he preached. He gave this motto against Paul's innovation: follow Jesus as he preached. The Pauline church received a violent jolt from Arius. So Pauline church was always under attack from Arius. They feared Arius, actually, the Trinitarian church. Like this, there were several Unitarians, Meletians in Egypt, Ebionites in another place, Serentians in another place, Basilidians another place, Corporations another place, Hippisisterians another place. There were several types of Unitarian Christians establishing elsewhere. Now, another important personality comes into existence in the history of Christianity is the Constantine Emperor. Constantine Emperor, he's an emperor of Constantine. He's an emperor, Constantine Emperor. And his son was gaining popularity. His son was gaining popularity. His another wife, the stepmother of his real son, stepmother of the son, she instigated Constantine Emperor to kill his son, and he killed his son. After killing his son, he was feeling remorse, he was very sad, and he was annoyed, and he was disturbed. And he was annoyed to this woman, the stepmother, who had instigated. So he burnt her in a boiling water. So he killed that woman also. After this, he felt very, very sorry that he had killed two persons. What to do? So he goes to his Jupiter temple. He goes to Jupiter temple saying that I have killed such and such people, two members of my family. Is there any salvation? There is way out for me in the religion? And they said, no, get out. Nothing. They rejected him. Get out. So he went to Trinitarian church. He went to Trinitarian church saying that I have killed my son, I have killed my wife, and is there any way out? And they say, no problem. You just believe Jesus died for your sins. Your sins are all forgiven. No problem. He was so happy. He was so happy that he started supporting the Trinitarian church. And that's the reason he took the Trinitarian church from Jerusalem to Rome. He established the Trinitarian church in Rome. And from then onwards, Rome is the establishment of the Christian church. From then onwards, Constantine Emperor picked up took it from there. Before Constantine, emperor's support to the Trinitarian Christians were like any other Christians, poor people. All were weaker sections. The Unitarians and Trinitarians all were equal in power. They were weak. But once they got the support of the emperor, they started flourishing. They started gaining power. But Constantine, what he did? He thought of an idea that my subjects, my people, they are Trinitarians, they are Unitarians. He was not so much in, he was inclined to the Trinitarians, but he was not into it completely. So he wanted to unite all the followers of Jesus Christ, the Unitarians and Trinitarians. So he said, let me call everyone with all the bishops of all the sections together, with all their books, what they have together, and have a council, and let us solve this problem of this division, and let us all unite as one body. So he had a good idea to unite people, and he brought all the bishops together at Council of Nicaea. So all the bishops, the Unitarians, the Trinitarians, all the bishops, they gathered together. And you have the list of these people. Participants were Eusebius of Caesarea, Arian at heart. He was Arian at heart. He was Unitarian at heart. Eusebius of Nicodemia, a staunch Arian. He was Arian at heart. He was Unitarian Christian. Athanasius of Alexandria. He was a staunch Trinitarian. Bishop Athanasius was a staunch Trinitarian. Like that, there were people who were not bothered of anything. The bishops, they were not concerned. Like Hosius, Spiridon, Pentamond, Osius, Mysor, and Nicholas. They were the such people who were not. Arius was another bishop who was staunch Unitarian Christian. So these were all called. Constantine wanted to resolve the matter between the factions of Christians, namely the Unitarian Christians and the Trinitarian Christians. Therefore, he called a meeting of Christian bishops with books in order to settle the matter once and for all. It is significant that no one from the church of Donatus was asked. Donatus people were not asked to join. The Donatus, the North African Christians, the Unitarian Christians, they were not asked. They were strong enough. They were not called for this meeting. Though the opposite party, the opposition party of Donatus, Sicilian, was invited. So Donatus was boycotted. Donatus was not invited. So what happened in the council? The discussion began. Apart from few learned men, the council was composed of men with a reputation of piety. They were all pious people. They were reputed for pious people, but not of learning. They were not learned people. They were pious people, but they were not of learning. Men whose hearts were pure, but whose tongues were not always articulate. Their hearts were pure, but their tongues were not articulate. Such participants were there. Scholars, people argued and argued, but certain people were articulate. Arius was articulate, Bishop Athanasius was articulate, certain group of people. So the discussion, the debate was between Arius and Bishop Athanasius together. These were the two persons debating, and everyone was just keep quiet. But bishops argued and argued. Formula for treaty was put forward. Formula for treaty was put forward by Bishop Athanasius. The treaty exists. But with no scripture evidence. But there was no scripture evidence by the Bishop Athanasius. They said Jesus was God. They said, the Bishop Athanasius said, Jesus was God. Arius replied, Jesus is of God. The Bishop Athanasius said, Jesus is of God. Therefore, he is God. So Bishop Arius replied, everything is of God. This will make everything as gods. So Bishop Athanasius says, Jesus is of God. So Bishop Arius says, everything is of God. So everything will become God. Athanasius said, Jesus was the essence of God. Jesus put, Athanasius, Trinitarian Christian, Athanasius put forward, Jesus was the essence of God. Jesus was the essence of God. All other bishops opposed. All the other bishops, they opposed. They pointed out these words were not to be found in the scripture. All the bishops unanimously, they objected to Bishop Athanasius that this is not found in the scripture, that he is the essence of God. Why you are saying that he is the essence of God? So they objected, so it was ruled out. Athanasius said that scripture says Jesus is the eternal image of the Father and true God. He said the scripture says that Jesus is the eternal image of the Father and true God. Arians replied, scripture also says that we men are the image and glory of God. Therefore, not only Jesus, but all men could claim to be divine. So he countered every argument of Bishop Athanasius. He was very strong, Arius. Thus, meeting was out of control, but they argued and argued, no compromise could take place. And this usually happens in such type of discussions. They cannot reach to conclusion. The meeting was out of control. Helena, the mother queen Helena, was Trinitarian. The mother of Constantine Emperor Helena, she was Trinitarian, and she was politician also. Sister Constantina, the sister of Constantine Emperor, she was Arian, she was Unitarian Christian. In the family, there are Trinitarians and Unitarians. So sister was, Constantina was Arian at heart, Arian and pious. Conditions developed if no decision for unity could be achieved. There was so much argument, 3 days, 4 days, they continued on and on. In fact, the cooks and other people, the sweepers, they started taking part in discussion. It was so out of control. So this particular situation reached that if there is no compromise, if there is no solution, if there is no unanimous agreement achieved, condition developed, if no decision for unity could be achieved, then the emperor will withdraw his support to Christians. Then the emperor will withdraw his support, which will result in the worse condition of both Christians. They feared that if unity is not achieved, then emperor will be against the Christians and it will be a problem to all of us. So because of this, they had to compromise. They came for compromise. Constantina, their sister, advised Eusebius of Nicodemia. Thus Arians softened, Trinitarians compromised. The sister and Eusebius of Nicodemia, they pacified Arius. Arius softened, and this is the mistake that Arius have did. He softened himself. And Trinitarians compromised. And Constantine Emperor declared four things here. Four things were declared. He declared the Roman Sunday to be the Christ Sabbath. Roman Sunday. Roman, they used to celebrate the Sunday. Sunday means birth of sun. You know birth of sun? Sun, it starts rising from the end point first, and that is the birth of sun. So that birth of Sunday was recognized for Jesus to be the Christian Sabbath. Sunday was the Sabbath day. Initially it was Saturday Sabbath day. Muslims have Friday, Alhamdulillah, Jumma Salah, not Sabbath-like Sabbath day. But now from here, Sunday was declared as Sabbath day. From then onward till today, it is Sunday only. Second point, 25th December was taken as the traditional birthday of Jesus Christ. Why? Because Constantine Emperor asked the bishops, what is the birthday of Jesus Christ, peace upon him? Asked the bishop, the Christians, the Unitarians and Trinitarians, what is the birthday of Jesus Christ? And they did not know the birthday of Jesus Christ. So he said, okay, if you don't know the birthday, no problem. We will take the birthday of our Jupiter God, 25th December, as the birthday of Jesus Christ. So 25th December was attributed to Jesus Christ here in Constantine, in Council of Nicaea as the birthday of Jesus Christ. Third, cross, the emblem of sun god, to be emblem of Christianity. There was swastika sign in paganism. That swastika sign was converted into cross sign. The cross sign was given here in Council of Nicaea, the third point. And fourth point, statue of Jesus replaced the idol of sun god. Statue of Jesus was replaced in place of Jupiter god. Sun god was removed and statue of Jesus was placed in the church. This is how the Trinitarian concept, Trinitarian version of Christianity got established in the Council of Nicaea. But it did not continue for long. But on the face of it, they were all united. On the face of it, it continued, but they were united. Unitarian and Trinitarian, on the superficial aspect, they were all united. So in the election, Arius got elected. So Arius, he became the unanimous leader of all the Christian, Unitarian and Trinitarian. So Arius became the head. If Arius became the head, then it was influence of Unitarian Christianity towards all the group. But in a short period of time, he was poisoned by the Trinitarians. He was poisoned by the Trinitarians. So he died. And then Trinitarians got the uphold. Later on, this continued. The conflicts continued. And in continued, the books into which Jesus teach, and the books which were there, he had brought in Council of Nicaea, the books were all collected in the hall. And then he said that the books that tomorrow will lock the hall whole night, and tomorrow whatever book which is on the table, that book will be considered to be the Word of God. So there were several books, several gospels, 400 such gospels. All the bishops have brought all the books. So the hall was locked, and the next day they opened the hall and they found Matthew, Mark, Luke and John on the table, four gospels on the table. Who had the key? Nobody has that report. So this is how all the books were under the table, and that was all burnt and destroyed. Dr. Stanley writes that if Athanasius, when young, had adopted the moderation which he showed in his old age, then the Catholic Church would not have been divided and much bloodshed would have been avoided. So once Dr. Stanley says, if Athanasius was calm and cool like he was in his old age, when he was young, then this problem would have not occurred. The books into which Jesus' teaching had gone were completely destroyed. The books in which the teaching of Jesus Christ was, it was completely destroyed, suppressed or changed in order to avoid any blatant contradiction with the doctrine. It was all avoided so that it should not contradict with the doctrine. Fra Fulgencio was reprimanded by the Pope in a letter saying, preaching of the scripture is suspicious thing. Preaching of the scripture is suspicious thing. He who keeps close to the scripture will ruin the Catholic faith. He who keeps close to the scripture, he will ruin the Catholic faith. He will quite destroy the Catholic Church. So do not come close to the scripture. Where it is said, Outlines of the History of Dogma, Adolf Harnack. Outlines of History of Dogma, Adolf Halgren. So there were several books which we know by name only, Gospel of Nazarenes destroyed, Gospel of Hebrews destroyed, Gospel of Egyptians destroyed, Gospel of Thomas destroyed, Gospel of Barnabas destroyed. It was found lately, one copy was discovered, and from then Gospel of Barnabas came into existence. Gospel of Thomas also is found, and Gospel of Thomas is now there. But it was all destroyed. Gospel of Barnabas destroyed, Shepherd of Hermes destroyed, but still it is found now, Shepherd of Hermes. Where we find this? The Bible, the Quran and Science by Boris Bukel, page number 90. these last books which were there, it was destroyed. The teachings of Jesus Christ which went in the books, these were all destroyed. So what happened? The Trinitarian Christians, they flourished like this. The Unitarian Christians, alhamdulillah, they flourished like this. And they had a conflict on and on. But when in 7th century, the message of Islam reached the Unitarian Christians, alhamdulillah, they accepted en masse. So this is how Muslims, alhamdulillah, we have majority of people. These were the Unitarian Christians. When they reached, when to them reached the message of Jesus Christ, which conformed with the teachings, alhamdulillah, they accepted. So now, after presenting this talk, presenting this message, ask the Christians, to which category of Christian do you belong? After explaining to them in detail, ask them, to which category of the Christians do you belong? So if you belong to this category of Christian, then you are deviated one. You are treated, you are deviated one, you are following the pagan type of worship. And time will not permit me to tell you how paganism has got influence. All the beliefs that the Christians they have today about dying for the sin, it is there in paganism. That he was there in the cave for 3 days, it is there in the paganism. That he got raised up the third day, it is there in paganism. And there was a mass slaughter of people, dead bodies were thrown into walls, bishops were murdered in the churches. Consequently, some named their church, Church of Martyr. So killings and burning of books were continued. Castillo, an admirer of Servetus, said that to kill a man is not to prove a doctrine. He said that to kill a man is not to prove a doctrine. So people are killing people. Conviction cannot be forced with a dagger. With this I conclude with a verse from Surat al-Imran, chapter 3, verse number 110, the second portion. وَلَوْ آمَنَ أَهْلُ الْكِتَابِ لَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ مِنْهُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَأَكْثَرُهُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. If only the people of the book had faith, it would be best for them, because among them are some Muslims, some Mormons, but most of them are perverted transgressors. وَآخْرُ دَوَانَا عَنِ الْحَمْدُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Prepared with the topic, concept of God in Christianity.
Alhamdulillah الَّذِي هَدَانَا إِلَى الْإِيمَانِ وَمَا كُنَّا لِنَهْتَدِيَ لَوْلَا أَنْ هَدَانَا اللَّهُ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْنَا رَسُولًا مُحْكَمَاتِ الْإِسْلَامِ أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رَبِّ اشْرَحْ لِي صَدْرِي وَيَسِّرْ لِي أَمْرِي وَاحْلُلْ عُقْدَةً مِّن لِّسَانِي يَفْقَهُوا قَوْلِي. My respected brothers and sisters in Islam, the chairman, invited guests, I welcome you all and I greet you in the name of Allah, and I greet you with the greeting of the people of Jannah, saying assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We read from the history books, also from the Quran, it is mentioned that the first creation from the humankind is Adam alayhi salam. Thus, when we see the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's when we see also that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he have got the power and the ability to create anything and any man in any how he wants. Adam alayhi salam was created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala using his own hands and from the clay and dust. So it means there was no father and there was no mother. Number two, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Hawa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Hawa from a man's rib. So that shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had the power and the ability to create a human being with only a father, without a mother. Number three, we learned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Isa alayhi salam with only a mother, without a father. So with that, my brothers and sisters, we realized and we learned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have got all the means and is capable of doing whatever he wants, like what he says in the Quran, kun fayakun. So our topic today is the concept of God in Christianity. So why I mentioned this, so that we know where the worship of God really comes from, and we saw that we also know where the Christians are going wrong. Because the Christians, if you ask them the reason why they worship Jesus alayhi salam, they tell you that his father is God. So we have given examples of the creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made those creations without any interference of human. So that does not give them the right to say Jesus alayhi salam is God. And we have learned that Jesus himself, he never mentioned that in the Bible. And Jesus himself, he has never proclaimed or claimed that he is God and should be worshipped. And we learn from the Bible that Jesus alayhi salam, a man came to him and then he grabbed his garment and said, Master. And then he pulled his garment and said, I am not the master but the one who has sent me. And we've learned from the Bible that Jesus alayhi salam, he rejected in several places that he is not God and he does not deserve to be worshipped. In Alilahi, because of the mix-up that has happened through after the Jesus Christ until today, the mix-up has led the Christians to worship Jesus alayhi salam. Them, they believe that they are on the right path, but our Quran says, he refuses that, and we learn from the Quran that they said, the meaning of which is, لَا يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا كَانُوا هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارَ. They say, you will not enter paradise until and unless that you become a Jew or a Christian, of which that is not the reality. The reality starts right from Adam alayhi salam, who taught the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we've learned several mistakes that has happened, that during the time of Constantine, people that endorsed the Trinitarian because to pursue their political careers. But we have learned that from several occasions that there are some Christians because they did not have political influence, their doctrines that stretch right to Jesus Christ alayhi salam was denied because they did not have the power to do so. So we say with these words, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us this tawfiq and the understanding to grasp the true teaching of Jesus and spread it also to the Yahud and Nasara. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations upon our masterpiece Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We also seek protection in Allah from Satan the accursed. In the name of Allah, the most merciful and most gracious, I also greet you, brothers and sisters, our guest, Dr. Shuaib, in the Islamic salutation, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My brothers and sisters, my focus today is on the topic, the concept of God in Christianity. I would like to approach the topic looking at the blasphemous phrases that we find in relation to who God is in Christianity. First and foremost, in the book of Genesis, we are told that on the sixth day, God was tired. And we know as a fact that God can never be tired. The logic behind this is that they are telling us that God rested on this particular day, but contrary, they also go in church on that particular day. My question is, if your boss tells you that I'm not working on Sunday, and you come to the business place, will you get paid for that Sunday? The answer is definitely no. So we also find that in Genesis, when you read the story of Abraham, may peace be upon him, when they say that when God came to the tent to Abraham and informed Abraham and Sarah of Sarah being pregnant or Sarah having to have a son, the Bible tells us that after a year, God went unto Sarah. My question is, how can we associate such an act of, you know, demeaning to God to say that God went into a human being and Isaac was born? So we read along the Bible. As we read the Bible, we find many things whereby we are told that Iblis, Satan, is the god of this world. The word God means the creator, and Iblis is not the creator. So how is he referred to as God? We also find in many places in the Old Testament whereby we are also told that the prophets were referred to God. But we all know that God means creator, the sole sustainer and cherisher of the universe. We also learn that the angels are also referred to as gods. Moving into the New Testament, we are told that in the birth of Isa, alayhi salam, that the Spirit of God was hovering over Mary. I don't know, hovering in this sense also means went unto Mary. Therefore, they come and tell us that Isa is the Son of God, claiming that perhaps God or the Spirit of God went into Mary in a sexual manner. So we also learn this, that these aspects are all blaspheming to the one and only Creator. As we move forward, as we examine the life of the so-called Son of God, we learn that he slept. I would like to ask anyone, if God sleeps, who's taking care of the universe? This God was hungry at some point and he went to a fig tree only to find that the fig tree had no fruits. So the question is this God confused about his own creation? He did not know that this was not the season of the figs. These are all mistakes that prove that Jesus was not a God. Jesus himself was thirsty at some point. He was hungry. All of these things are human inclinations. These are not inclinations of the one and only sole creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I would also like to narrate one of the verses that I think is the most blasphemous. The verse goes, and God came, and darkness was under his feet. And through his nose, I don't know whether Allah has a nose, but they say through his nose, there was smoke coming out. You know, like people who smoke and then they doubt. You know, they also tell us that God, flames were coming out of his mouth. If God has a mouth, therefore flames were coming out of his mouth and coals were kindled by it. Like today you'll find at the circus, there's one guy always blowing those flames. So they're telling us that God was doing all of this. And God was riding a cherub. My brothers and sisters, a cherub is a young, girlish angel. Perhaps if you have seen a photo of a cherub, you'd notice it's a very, you know, young teenage angel with curves and all of that. And they are saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was riding a cherub and, you know, sussing out the world. I don't think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can be beaten by Spider-Man, who uses web to fly, or Superman, who doesn't even need anything to fly. And they are telling us that fire was coming out of his mouth. My opinion about this verse is that now this is where Christianity is trying to attract people from those faiths and religions who believe in dragons and having dragon-like features, because we all know a dragon blows out fire and there's smoke coming out of his nose. So all these things are blasphemous to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With this short message, I would like to thank you all. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I like to quote an ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created his mankind. It says, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. By quoting this ayah, I like to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala